exciting weekend for many. I heard that a lot of people took off Friday off of work and don't work Monday, so they have like a 5-day weekend for the 4th of July. And I know that there's a lot of plans, seeing fireworks and cookouts and family gatherings. And so I hope everybody has a wonderful weekend and enjoys their time. I know one of the things is Caitlin, remember Caitlin in prayers, Caitlin's on a horse team today, which is Bible camp. It's Bible camp and horse camp. And so anyway, you know, it's a combination of Jesus loves me and I'm back in the saddle with him. Oh, come on, that was fun. No, what made you like? How many years have you been to this camp in a row, Caitlin?
Seven.
So she's got some friends that will be back, be there, right? You know, we'll see once a year. And so be praying for Caitlin. She has a good time up at the community. It's a blessing that they do that. It's real interesting. I mean, they have all kinds of camps. You have paintball camp and just all kinds of specialized camps for things that you're into. Yeah. So it's a blessing. So be praying for her that she has a wonderful time. And God blesses us in all kinds of things. I had a wedding last night. And Morgan and Cody Taylor are on their way to like Orlando this morning. They had an early flight. But they, I married them at a place called Little Bear Golf Club. And if you don't think that the devil can distract you, then I'm not going to preach this wedding, give these vows, and the entire side wall is nothing but huge windows of great big greens with people putting. And you look down a little bit, there's an island green surrounded by a lake. It was just absolutely gorgeous. And I'm sitting there trying to keep my mind on that. But it was a blessing. It was a wonderful wedding and a couple of great kids. And so just ask that God blesses them and they'll be back. They asked a lot of questions about the church and hoping that they'll come back. Because they're people that I can't imagine. I get very excited about them. You know what's great about them? They've never been to church. It's not somebody from the Lutheran church. It's not somebody from the Methodist church. It's two people who have never been in church. And I was blessed to say that share the gospel with them for 10 hours and preach last night. And the last thing he said is, he said, "We'll see you in a few weeks." And I have to be honest with you. I didn't do it, but I almost did that. Yeah, sure. That you give to everybody. I said, okay, thank you. No, I'm serious. So I'm praying that they will be here. But today we're going back in the sermon series. And, you know, we talked about things piling on last week. And can you believe there's a God when things are piling on? And you think that things are really bad and things can't get any worse. And then a lot of times in life, as soon as you think that things are really bad and they can't get any worse, they can get even worse. Did you know that? I mean, you can't tell me if God went around and gave you these things, you can't tell me that you haven't had a time in your life where you think things are even worse. I remember 1997, and I went to see Dr. Khan this week, and I kind of screwed up. I should have put his picture. I put a picture of him on Facebook. I put a picture on Facebook, and I kind of cracked up because I forgot. I never realized how short he is or how tall I am, because when I hugged him, he came up to about right here. But anyway, he's just a great, great man, a great, great doctor. And in 1997, I went through the chemo, and the chemo almost killed me. And they took out my spleen in May as part of the treatment. And my numbers are going up, and I think it's pretty good. And after I come conscious, Dr. Khan came in the room and he said, "Listen, I'm just going to tell you flat out, because we've been real honest about everything. We found a few masses in your liver and we did biopsies before you went in there. We think you have liver cancer." But wait a minute. I had leukemia that I wasn't going to live through. I barely survived their nutso experimental chemo. They went in and taken out my spleen. Have you been there? Have you been there where, here's the break. This is when it gets better. This is when things get exciting. And all of a sudden, no. It doesn't get exciting. It's not good. It's not anything good happening. This is just where we are. And when it's like that, it's not only tough not to lose your faith, but we're known as good and faithful servants. And it's a place where a lot of Christianity is lacking today, because just because things are bad doesn't mean that you can stop serving God. You understand that? There's always some things for you to do to serve God, to be a servant. And a lot of people, you know, things get bad and then they get worse. And when that happens, they question their faith. Their faith is just gone. They don't believe, and when they don't believe, they don't serve. They don't remain faithful to God. And the problem is that in bad times, can you believe that God is there? Can you believe that? Can you understand and know that God is there? He is there in what you're trying to do and what you want to do. And it's hard for people to understand. People want to think that God has deserted them. So they walk away. And they don't do it. And you know, when things are bad, what do we know? What comes along in self-pity, right? We like to wallow in self-pity. Like, get all the boys in there. And that's the thing we believe that God has deserved us, but God never deserves us. And so the question we ask today is, what do you truly believe? What do you truly believe happens? And before we go into this, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we come to you today knowing that you never deserve us, that you're always there for us, and there are things that you have chosen for each and every one of us to go through. And I just ask that you would bless us today to hear your word and to understand and to look at Joseph's life and to realize that we have a God that never walks away. Who promises that I will be with you until the end of time. You are always there. Help us to understand that and to accept that and to know that, and for it to give us confidence so that no matter what's going on, We will know. So the question is, have you ever felt below the worst? Have you ever felt like there is no hope? Have you ever had the question, why am I alive? Why am I alive? Things are so bad. Why doesn't God just take me? Why am I going through all of these things? I've spent a lot of time in the oncology office. And a lot of you have never been in an oncology office. And you sit around. You know, I went this week, and when I got there, I don't know, but I would swear to you, there was 100 people. Every seat was full, and people were standing against the walls, waiting for appointments. And it's just terrible. The condition that you see people in, the condition that their families are in, that are sitting there, and the depression that is there, and the sadness that is there. And we can get like that. We can, why am I alive? Why am I going through this? And we can also ask the tough question, is God here? Because we have this thing that when God is here, everything's great, right? Everything is fantastic. Everything's perfect, you know. We're eating the best food. We've got money. It's really easy in Hillhead, South Carolina to know that God is there. It's a little bit different when you're waiting to find out how bad your cancer is. And a little bit harder. And we ask ourselves, is God here? Genesis 40, 1 through 4. While Joseph was in prison, both the king's personal servant and his chief cook made the king angry. So he had them thrown into the same prison with Joseph. They spent a long time in prison, and Potiphar, the official in charge of the palace guard, made Joseph their servant. So Joseph is in prison. And if you remember last week, he is in a prison where he is falsely accused. He's in jail for the wrong reason. I mean, his brothers have already tried to kill him. He's been sold into slavery. He went into slavery and did his very best. And then a woman lied about him, and so he's in prison. Right? And he's sitting here going through all of this. And what is his attitude? He continues to work. And now he has to be servant. Joseph becomes a servant to new prisoners. Now, it's one thing to be a prisoner. Can you imagine new prisoners come in and you are assigned as their slave? You go from your dad is Israel, right, to slave to prisoners. And every day, it seems new challenges and things are just getting worse. And this has also been going on for a long time. It says they spent a long time in prison. A long time. We don't like long times of being patient, do we? We don't like long times of suffering. We don't like long times of going through bad things. And yet, one thing I can promise you, it's going to happen in your life. It's going to happen. The bad things are going to come. And you're going to experience this. And as you're experiencing this, can you be faithful? Can you continue to serve God? As things go on, what can you do to serve God as you're in the predicament that you're in? I had to laugh. Last week I told you guys the story about Dr. Carr keeping me for 2 hours every day. I went to get blood because he liked me calming people down in the office. You remember that story? We were here last week. So this week, I go to Dr. Khan's last talk. Now, I don't mind standing in line to get my blood test. I don't mind standing in line to get my lymph node scan. I don't mind standing in line to see the doctor. But lately, it has been so bad, we've been standing in line to pay the bill. It's wrong to stand in line to pay the bill. Everybody in agreement with that? Okay? So I'm standing in line to pay the bill, and I've actually been in line to pay the bill for 20 minutes. And this is nothing that Dr. Khanna has set up or anything, because all these people are standing in line. And this guy comes up, about 42 years old behind me, I guess, and he just is scared to death. Scared to death. And I look at him, and every nurse that goes by, he's saying the same thing. I'm sorry I acted like that. I'm sorry I acted like that. I'm sorry I acted like that. And I'm thinking, what do you do? What do you do? I mean, you know, this is, and so he looks at me and he goes, I'm sorry I'm acting like this. I'm really a bastard case. You know, he said, you're not going to believe this. I have cancer. And I looked at him and I said, shh. And he said, really? And I said, yeah. And I said, 20 years ago, they said, I was going to live for the people. I said, but you know what? These are some of the best doctors I've ever had. And I'm going to tell you, they tell me that one of the reasons that I survived is I did every single thing they told me to do. If they told me to get up in the bathroom at 1 o'clock in the morning, I set an alarm and got up at 1 o'clock in the morning. I took a pill. If I said, take a pill at 1:22 in the morning, I didn't say, well, I'll get up at 2:15. I did exactly what they said. And I said, between that and prayer, I got through. And you really just feel it. Because if you ask God, he'll take care of you. Trust him. And this guy just calms down. His face comes up. And he's a whole new guy. And he starts joking with his wife about stuff. And he starts thanking me. And I went back to hug all the nurses because it was my last time to be there. And he comes back with me. He says, I just want to thank you again. I just want to thank you again. And in the same way, he was telling everybody how sorry he was. He started thanking me. But the thing is That's what God's calling us to do. I'm not perfect by any chance. I told you I wrote this sermon series for you, but one of the reasons is to realize when things are really bad. Because if you're at that, apologize, things aren't good like that. You gotta forget what's going on with you. You gotta think about other people. Because it's all that God's word calls us to do. It calls us to serve Him and be servants to other people and to work for other people and to learn to take the mind off of ourselves and stay focused on other people. And the thing is, can you worship and praise God when things are really bad? And can you serve God when things are really bad? And I mean, things can be bad. It's not just cancer. People can be talking bad about you. They can be putting you down. You have family that are stabbing you in the back. I tell you, I go through all these things and see all these people and money. I'm really blessed. I think when the Lord takes me home, that there won't be 50 cents left behind. And there's no way I can say I love you and my children any more than no inheritance. Because I'm watching this stuff. I'm watching these families and how they treat each other. I mean, sometimes it's a lot of money. Sometimes it's not $2,000. And they'll start going after each other. It's terrible stuff. And when you're going through that stuff, can you serve God? In 5-22, it says, one night each of the two men had a dream. Their dreams had different meanings. The next morning when Joseph went to see the men, he could tell they were upset. He asked, why are you so worried today? We each had a dream last night, they answered, and there is no one to tell us what they mean. Joseph replied, doesn't God know the meaning of dreams? Now tell me what you dream. The king's personal servant told Joseph, in my dream, I saw a vine, a branch. As soon as it budded, it blossomed and its grapes became ripe. I held the king's cup and squeezed the grapes into it. Then I gave the cup to the king. Joseph said, the meaning of your dream. The three branches stand for 3 days, and in 3 days the king will pardon you. He will make his personal servant again, and you will serve him as wine, just as you used to do. But when these good things happen, please don't forget to tell the king about me so I can get out of this place. I was kidnapped from the land of the Hebrews, and here in Egypt I haven't done anything to deserve being thrown in jail. When the chief cook saw that Joseph had given a good meaning to the dream, he told Joseph, I also had a dream. It was carrying three bread baskets stacked on top of my head. The top basket was full of all kinds of baked things for the king, but birds were eating them. And Joseph said, the meaning of your dream is that the three baskets are 3 days, and in 3 days the king will cut off your head. He will hang your body on a pole, and birds will come and peck at it. 3 days later, while the king was celebrating his birthday with a dinner for his officials, he sent for his personal servant, the chief cook. He put the personal servant back in his old job and had the cook put to death. Everything happened just as Joseph said it would. You see, Joseph listens to God, even things that are really bad. And he hears these two men, and he interprets the dreams. Because that's why God has him there. He wants him. This is all part of God's plan. You see, as things are bad, God has a plan, and he expects you to do something in the middle of the plan. He expects you to do something to serve him. And that's where we can fall short a lot of times. If you're in the middle of something bad, do you think, what does God want me to do for him? Not for me, but for him. And this is both good news and bad news. God honors Joseph in what he's doing, because he makes it correct. Because we do know that if you say you're talking for God and you're incorrect, the penalty from Moses has been that you were stoned to death. But he's right on, because he listens to God, he's obedient to God, he tells these men the news. And one of the things that he does is that he delivers bad news. The kids asked me a few months ago if I would start teaching you through 1 Kings. So we went through one of my favorite chapters in the Bible the other night. We went through 1 Kings 18. I was talking to him about the sermon. There's a guy named Obadiah. And he runs into Elijah. And Elijah says, go tell Ahab I'm coming. And he says, I don't want to, because if I give him bad news, he'll kill me. servants were killed for bad news. See, that would stop a lot of bad news coming into your house if you could just kill the person who brought the bad news. The only problem is we wouldn't be able to keep people working in the post office. Right? Because every time bad news, you get a bad letter, you get ill. And what happened is they killed the servants. Yet, even though he is a man's servant, he tells them that he is going to be killed. He tells him that the king's going to take off his head. And Joseph tells him it's not cocky, not just as the truth. He had faith, so he spoke the truth. He spoke the truth. There's a lot of times we can get in predicaments and people can be after us and stuff, and we cannot stand for the truth. Amen? Amen? We can waver and we can say what's best, what people want to hear, right? It's not always popular to stand for God. And when it's really a bad time, it's really easier not to stand for God. It's really easier to waver and say, hey, you know, it's enough, I'm going through this. I don't need people mad at me. Amen? Because that's not what Joseph did. And that's not what we're doing. We're called to tell God's truth. We're called to be what he calls us to be. And Joseph did this. Now, Joseph did have a moment of weakness. Because instead of trusting God to get him out of there, what does he do? He asked them to get him out. Remember me and tell me the king. And guess what happens? We're going to talk about different day about it. And there's a lesson in that. You know? Jim in Sunday school this morning asked the question, have we ever tried to invent our own miracles? And see, Joseph in the middle of things, he tries to do things on his own. He tries to do things on his own. Get me out of this place. He kind of loses that little thing in God. And he asks them for help. Because he's not perfect. But we're not perfect. But what if it gets worse? What if we think things are really bad, and then all of a sudden it even gets further worse? When we're serving God, it gets worse. Well, what if God lets you see the light? Joseph sees the light here. He tells these guys the truth. He knows that the vision he's given them from God is accurate. And then all of a sudden the bottom drops out. Genesis 40:23. But the king's personal servant completely forgot about Joseph. And you know, I'll tell you, this is the one that really gets me. And I've really worked hard on this. Joseph didn't have it. Jesus said that when things get really bad in our lives, that once we see an empty tomb, nothing will ever be able to make us sad or rob our joy. Did you know that? I didn't say that. In the book of John, Jesus said, when you see that empty tomb, nothing is really wrong with you. Do you ever think about that when things are really bad? When you're really hurting? When the world is really attacking you? When the devil's knocking at your door? Do you ever stop and see the empty tomb? What a change. What a change it brings. I did my uncle's graveside service. I tell you, I went to the doctor the other day, and he said, you have to lose stress. He said, I'm not kidding, kidding. If you don't lose stress, you're going to die. And I looked at him, and he said, do you know what I do for a living? And he said, do you know what I do for a living? He said, you know how much I loved your mom and dad? I said, yeah. He said, I want to remember my stepmother and grandma. He said, I didn't want to remember your mom and dad died without any of your family. He said, I turned it over to God. He said, I'm retired after 41 years of this. He said, if I didn't learn how to do that, I would die right after. And I went on for 5 minutes and I wanted it. And all I could think about was God saying, nothing will be able to rob you of joy. Don't you see the empty tomb? It's true. We get so stressed. We get so the world can come at us and tear at us for so many ways. But you know what? Once we see the empty tomb, there's no victory for death or death. The worst thing the world can do is kill us. Amen? There's nothing worse that the world can do to you. The world can kill your body, and it can't kill your soul. You're gonna be with Jesus at the moment that you die. And I asked a lot of you for prayer from my friend Todd Paul. Todd Paul is one of our sponsors in AA, and he's been with us since the very beginning. And I was blessed to see Todd Paul on his first date with a wonderful young woman, Christy. I was blessed to be at Todd Paul's wedding. His father married him. And I just really enjoyed the relationship and their friendship. And about 3 months ago, Paul's wife died. And they only were married 5 years. And I was talking to people last night who were really good friends with him, and they said that when Christy was dying the night before, she'd been in real depression. And that she kind of came to consciousness. She was just happy and loving on her way, loving everybody. And everybody said, what changed you? What is going on? And she said, Jesus is coming to sit with me for now. And he told me it wasn't time to take things. He said, he'd be back in a few hours. But just to tell y'all that it's very, very real. He's coming to take me. And it changed Paul. And he feels bad. All the people that were in the room. Chris Corbin told me last night, she said, I've never seen anything like it in my life. She said, it changes how I walk every day. You guys just think about it. You go to the oncologist's office, you don't need to freak out and lose the ability to serve God because you're not going to die. You can have problems in your marriage. God is going to restore things in your life. You're never going to die. You can have business problems. Your business can be going on in the tank. You're never going to die. People can be treating you like garbage. They can lie about you. They can stab you in the back. They can do all kinds of things. It doesn't matter. You're never going to die. God is in complete charge. And once you accept Him, He has a plan, and you're going to go with it until you're with Him forever. He had a plan for Joseph. As we see, Joseph saves Israel. God saves Israel, but He does it through Joseph. He can only save Israel through Joseph if Joseph is obedient and continues to serve. And it's amazing because He could have set Joseph up in a palace, right? And done everything and just made his life easy. But no, He put him through all these steps. So He would go through all these things. And that's exactly what He's doing to us, because every step we go through increases your dependency on God. Amen? Everything that you go through that's bad increases your dependency and your trust in God. And our question today is simply this. Do you remember the empty tomb? Do you remember the empty tomb when you're going through bad things and your bad days? And life is just awful, and you feel like, why is this coming at me? Do you stop and remember the empty tomb? Do you remember that Jesus is risen Savior? Do you remember that He died for you? And that He rose again so that you would never have to? And that's all done? And then someday, one way or another, He's coming to get you so that you will live forever. If you want this in your life, we offer an invitation right now that you can come.
I love this.